I'm Naheem, and I'm a PhD student at UCL, and my work is funded by the Dominic Parker Trust, and I research the brain basis of stammering and how to improve therapeutic approaches using brain stimulation. So essentially trying to figure out what goes on in the brain when people stammer. So I use various forms of brain imaging to look at what goes on in the brain of people who stammer, to try and understand and really why things like blocks actually happen, and why they seem to vary across situations and across words as well. And hopefully if we can understand that as well, we can try and improve the therapies which are out there at the moment. And it's really just about trying to understand more about stammering and trying to improve the options out there for people who stammer to try and improve a quality of life overall. It's a real sort of privilege to be able to work on this sort of research, because there's not a lot of stammering research which is happening around the world. And it's also quite interesting to be able to have a peek behind the curtain, in a sense, or to see what's going on in the brain, and also my brain as well. It also gives me a lot of exposure to various things and allows me to do things that I thought I couldn't do previously. So I'm also always proving my old self wrong, and I'm sort of proving wrong the people who said that I couldn't or shouldn't do certain things, like teach students or give a lecture or do presentations and all those sorts of things. I'm doing those on a regular basis, and I'm pushing myself constantly, so it allows me to put myself in an environment where I'm always pushing myself and challenging myself and challenging my stammer as well. I would say go ahead and stammer, and then carry on talking anyway, because there's nothing bad that can happen out of it, really. You're not going to kill anyone by their eyes stammering. And you know, once you're at university and once you're in the world of work, you tend to quickly realize that people care a lot more about what you have to say rather than how you say it. And it's just and people are really open, and people are really willing to understand, and people are very interested in learning about stammering as well. So it's kind of up to you, in a sense, to be an ambassador for stammering too, because you have the opportunity to educate other people, and you have the opportunity to improve the environment, not only for yourself but for other people who stammer as well. And so just take the time to talk to as many people as you can, your friends, your family, people when you work with, your people who are interviewing you as well. Just talk to them about stammering, and you'll find that people are interested, and people will respect you for it, and they won't hold it against you either. Yeah, I would also say work towards this self-acceptance rather than fluency. I mean, it took me quite a long time to realize that self-acceptance is not giving up on the idea of having a normal life, and self-acceptance isn't about accepting the anxiety around your stammer. It's self-acceptance is rejecting the anxiety and stress around your stammer, and it's the refusal to be in this kind of adversarial relationship with yourself. It's learning to live with your stammer and doing things alongside your stammer and achieving and thriving alongside your stammer, and not sort of pushing against it as well, and just trying to move along with your stammer. I would just encourage people to just get involved with as many things as you can. So, you know, all sorts of events and support groups, and just meet other people who stammer, and realize that just because you stammer, it doesn't have to hold you back at all. You can use it as a thing to push you forward rather than hold you back. I would say that my stammer held me back initially in my early years. I spent a lot of energy trying not to stammer and avoiding stammering, and I feel I missed out on a few things, and I wasn't as social as I could have been in those early years. And you know, I should have experienced more things. But I see my stammer as kind of a slingshot, and in that it held me back for so long, but now I've been released from it and it's propelling me forward now. And I wouldn't be where I am if I didn't stammer. I wouldn't be working on the things I'm working on without my stammer. And I always make it a point to not let my stammer hold me back now, so whenever I get the creeping thoughts, or you know, maybe this this won't go the way you planned, or maybe this person will laugh at you, or maybe you shouldn't be doing this, or whenever I feel that kind of anxiety coming, you know, I make it a point to just do the opposite of what those thoughts are saying. So I never really let my stammer hold me back now. I don't avoid situations anymore either. And you know, I've done pretty much everything I thought I couldn't do previously, and the things that people said I couldn't do, shouldn't do, like presentations and lectures and teaching students. And I've even tried stand-up and comedy as well. And you know, I've done all of that and it's been fine, and I stammered proudly through all of it. And it's just a part of me, and it's what makes me, and it's not something to hide away from. It's something to sort of embrace more than anything, because once you embrace your stammer, you realize it's okay just to be you, and it's okay, and you are actually capable of doing all the things you want to do, and your stammer isn't the limitation you thought it is.